Thank you. Can I remind members of the COVID-related measures that are in place and that face coverings should be worn when moving around the chamber and across the Holyrood campus? The next item of business is a debate without motion on the subject of a progressive approach to sustainable procurement and fair work practices. I would invite those members who wish to speak in the debate to please press the request to speak buttons now. And I call on Richard Lochhead, Minister, to open the debate. Up to 11 minutes, please.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer, and thank you for the opportunity to Parliament to discuss the Scottish Government's fair work policy and our recent announcements, including that on mandating the real living wage in its contracts. And no doubt today we'll be discussing not only Scotland's journey towards becoming a fair work nation by 2025, as pointed to by our current consultation, but also some of the issues that were to the forefront throughout COVID in terms of people's employment circumstances and experience in their workplaces. And of course, also given we're meeting against the backdrop of COP26, some of the issues are extremely relevant to the just transition and how we make our way towards our net zero targets of 2045 in Scotland. And fair work is central to our economic strategy. As employment law is currently reserved to Westminster, the Scottish Government is, of course, unable to improve statutory rights and protections for workers directly through legislation. And in the absence of these employment powers, we are doing all we can to promote fairer working practices across the labour market. And we are committed to using all the levers that are available, for example, through our public spend, as well as promotion through every relevant policy agenda to make fair work the norm and go beyond the minimum statutory employment rights and protections. We have maintained our fair work focus during the pandemic and made opposition to fire and rehire and support for flexible working criteria in Fair Work First, increasing security and opportunity for workers. Also in August, we launched a Living Hours Accreditation Scheme for Scotland. It acknowledges that in addition to payment of the real living wage, it is of course essential to address the number and frequency of work hours, which are also critical to tackling in-work poverty. The Fair Work Convention's 2016 framework says that Fair Work offers all individuals an effective voice, opportunity, security, fulfilment and respect that balances the rights and responsibilities of employers and workers that can bring benefits for individuals, organisations and society. I also want to take this opportunity to record my thanks to the Convention for its valuable work to advance this agenda, which is a priority for the Scottish Government and many others in this chamber. And we are committed to this framework, and we have always been clear that the Scottish Government will lead the way on fair work. Our 2019 Fair Work Action Plan laid strong foundations for implementing our approach, setting out the key levers we have committed to use in order to set a clear example both as an employer and through using our substantial investment in the services provided for the people of Scotland and our support for Scotland's business community. And in the face of significant uncertainty due to Brexit and COVID-19, the Scottish Government is resolute in our commitment to making fair work the norm for workers across Scotland and to achieve more inclusive and sustainable growth. And we're responding to a number of issues facing employers and workers at the moment, such as the labour shortages, and through the development of a working with business action plan, we're focusing on employability, skills and fair work principles to address these labour shortages. And again, as we meet against the backdrop of COP26, key to this strategic approach we're taking is a just transition, which aims to create high-quality, good and green jobs across the country as we transition to net zero. COP26 is a good opportunity to reaffirm and share our commitment to delivering a greener, fairer economy in Scotland, while learning from the experience and approaches taken in many other countries. And as Minister for Just Transition, after I leave this debate today, I'm heading to COP26 to participate in my first in-person event in relation to the Just Transition, and have a whole full diary for the next 2 weeks. So it's great to see the interest in the Just Transition and fair work from across the global community in Glasgow this week. And fair work will be central to our new 10-year national strategy for economic transformation, putting us on the path to meeting our 2030 climate targets and helping restore the natural environment while raising workplace standards. And we have to make sure that these new jobs are good jobs, complying with high workplace standards and paying fair wages. That is true across the economy, but especially important in sectors vital for reaching net zero, where a lot of our public investment is going to be targeted. And to give an example of how Fair Work can contribute to a just transition, we recently announced a £1.8 billion programme to invest in energy efficiency and renewable heat solutions for Scotland's housing stock, and we will introduce Fair Work First criteria as a condition of public contracts relating to the spend in a way that's relevant and proportionate, but demonstrating how public money can ensure that green jobs are also good jobs. And continuing to drive forward action on Fair Work, on the 14th of October, we were pleased to inform Parliament that, with the immediate effect at that point, the Scottish Government is mandating payment of the real living wage in our contracts. That announcement and our recently extended Fair Work First criteria supports our vision, shared with the Fair Work Convention since 2016, for Scotland to be a leading Fair Work nation by 2025. Sure.
Stephen Kerr.
Thank you, and thank you to the Minister for giving way. Does the Minister welcome the rise in the national living wage announced in last week's budget, and that it meets and exceeds the promise of the Fair Work pledge of the Scottish Government?
Minister Richard Lockhead.
I welcome it as a step forward, but it certainly doesn't go nearly far enough, and I'm sure we'll return to that later in my speech or my closing remarks later on in this debate. But can I say that we are now consulting now on how we do progress our vision for Fair Work, and we want to encourage a wide response, and of course people in Scotland have until December the 23rd to respond to our current consultation. The Scottish Government's commitment to Fair Work aligns with the right to just and favourable working conditions, including remuneration, established in the United Nations Universal Declaration of Human Rights. And our commitment is demonstrated in our National Performance Framework and underpinned by the Fair Work Conventions Framework. It's tantamount to a determination on this agenda that the Scottish Government was the first government in the UK to achieve living wage accreditation. Fair Work is good for business, good for workers and good for our economy. In line with the Fair Work Convention, the Fraser of Allender Institute back in 2016 recognised that treating workers fairly will help create more diverse and inclusive workplaces where workers have greater security of pay and contract, can develop their skills and have an effective voice in the workplace. It can improve well-being and motivation and enable employers to recruit, grow and retain skilled people. All of this increases productivity, innovation and creates value. Through our landmark agreement with the Scottish Green Party, we also have agreed that by summer 2022 and within the limits on devolved competence, we will introduce a requirement on public sector grants recipients to pay at least the real living wage and to provide appropriate channels for effective workers' voices, such as trade union recognition. And we will engage with unions, businesses and others to agree the detail of this conditionality to ensure it is proportionate and effective in delivering real benefits we all want to see. So we are working across government and with industry to embed Fair Work in construction, for instance. We are working with the sector to develop a construction accord in line with Scottish Government priorities, due to be agreed this year. The accord will comprise a shared vision for the industry, including a strong commitment to Fair Work practices that will help create more diverse and inclusive workplaces. And this shared vision for the industry will include a strong commitment to Fair Work and support delivery of our strategy for affordable housing and other key projects. Significant work, I'm sure as many members are aware, is also underway in terms of progress for Fair Work in the adult social care area. The Fair Work and Social Care Group has developed a set of recommendations for minimum terms and conditions reflecting their Fair Work principles now that are being taken forward as part of that work, collaborating with all the key stakeholders working together. And since 2016, we've provided funding to ensure that adult social care staff delivering direct care are paid at least the real living wage, currently £9.50 per hour, but about to go up in a couple of weeks' time, I'm sure. Already this year, we have provided £64.5 million for this purpose, and last month, we committed to provide additional funding of up to £48 million to uplift the hourly rate for these workers to at least £10.02 per hour from the 1st of December this year. The significant funding in this year alone recognises the incredible contribution our social care workforce provide, and it's a significant step forward in terms of delivering our commitment to embed Fair Work in social care. Turning to the announcement on mandating the real living wage in our contracts, without control over employment legislation, we continue to use public procurement to drive fair pay. And under the Procurement Reform Scotland Act 2014, public bodies have been required to demonstrate their living wage policy in procurement strategies and report success since 2016. This supporting guidance and engagement has helped ensure that over 90% of Scottish Government suppliers have committed to paying at least the real living wage in our contracts. We have established it is now possible to require payment of the real living wage to workers in public contracts, where Fair Work First practices, including payment of the real living wage, are relevant and proportionate to contract delivery by UK-based workers. The Scottish Government now mandates payment of the real living wage in our contracts and encourages the rest of the public sector to follow suit. We believe business will appreciate this clarity because it levels a playing field for those wishing to bid for public contracts, removing the risk that businesses who pay their workers a real living wage will not be undercut by those or will be undercut by those who don't. Yes.
Briefly, yes. Willie Rennie.
If this policy is such a success, why was it not delivered years ago when many in this chamber were begging the government to deliver it?
Minister.
Well, our legal advice is always being updated, and as a result of the agreement with the Greens, we revisited that, and of course now we are told that we are able to do this, and that's why we are doing it. As you know, we have made significant progress in Scotland through working with the sectors and encouraging that over many years. And now we're going one step further, which I'm sure supported right across the chamber. And to give one example, the new civil engineering framework being developed will include real living wage as a condition of contract, and it will be available for use across the public sector and has an expected value of £600 million over 4 years. Meanwhile, we issued a procurement policy update clarifying that we expect public bodies to incorporate Fair Work First into all relevant procurement processes from financial year 22-23. And our reporting framework will enable us to monitor implementation progress across the whole of the sector. So I look forward to members' comments today and support in realising our Fair Work Nation vision. And I remind members that we have a consultation out, and this is an important opportunity for you all to come forward with how you think we can continue the momentum to ensuring Scotland's a Fair Work Nation by 2025. Thank you.
Thank you, Minister. And I now call on Tess White. Around 7 minutes, please, Ms White.
Presiding Officer, the past 18 months have been unimaginably difficult for businesses and for workers. People have been tested to their limits. Now, perhaps more than ever, we're looking at how we work and our financial security. We have some good news, and the UK economy is recovering more quickly than expected. And like many others, I was really pleased to hear the announcement from the Chancellor that the national living wage is set to increase by 6.6% in 2022. It's going to £9.50 an hour, giving millions on low incomes a pay rise of more than £1,000 a year. But difficult challenges do, of course, remain. As world leaders gather in Glasgow for COP26, the implications of climate change loom large for decision makers. For thousands of energy sector workers in the North East, the region I represent, ensuring a fair and managed transition to an integrated energy sector is critical. And I met with Oil and Gas UK yesterday to discuss this further. Presiding Officer, as we seek to recover from COVID-19, there's an opportunity for lawmakers and businesses to look at the existing landscape and take stock. What conditions will help us facilitate growth, to remove barriers to employment so that everyone who wants to work can, to close the persistent gender pay gap, which widened over the past year? How can we make business practices more sustainable across the whole supply chain? How can we support local economies across Scotland as they reboot post-public health measures? The SNP government has significant powers. They have the significant powers at their disposal to address these questions, including full powers over education and skills, oversight of business support agencies, including Scottish Enterprise, and the control of public spending powers through procurement. Indeed, global management consultancy McKinsey highlights that 2/3 of the average company's environment, social and governance footprint lies with suppliers. There is great potential through procurement to address environmental, social and governance issues. In the speeches that follow, my Conservative colleagues will look at the procurement system in Scotland and how it can be harnessed effectively to meet some of these challenges. And they're underpinned by openness and transparency. Presiding Officer, after working at a senior level in HR for 30 years, I often talk about the importance of collaborative working to avoid silos. Consultation and engagement on questions I have raised is key, but I do fear the voices of businesses are not being heard by the SNP Green Coalition. Take, for example, the hospitality sector. Workers in this sector tend to be younger, and it's amongst the sectors with the highest proportion of women in its workforce. IPPR Scotland suggests it will need ongoing support to rebuild following the pandemic. The Scottish Hospitality Group has repeatedly warned the Scottish Government about COVID-19's devastating impact on the sector. I've got 1 minute to go, so I won't, thank you. And yet the SNP refused to give hospitality and leisure businesses a full year's worth of non-domestic rates relief to provide some financial headroom until the Scottish Conservatives secured a U-turn earlier this year. Now, already in a fragile state, the hospitality sector is dealing with the fallout of the vaccine passport shambles. The vice chairman of the NTIA in Scotland, whose hospitality group owns a number of venues in the northeast, said last week, "It's utterly bewildering. The Scottish government have completely ignored the warnings from sectoral experts. It has taken just 1 week for our concerns around market distortion, unfair competition, discrimination, and the severe economic impact to be proven true." Presiding Officer, I make these points because the Scottish Government's decisions affecting the operating environment for this sector. It follows that these decisions affect hospitality workers who face losing up to £200 in wages a week because of this poorly executed scheme. The SNP claims it doesn't have sufficient levers to promote fair work. I think the problem is in the engine room. In the programme for government, the First Minister reiterated her party's support for a four-day working week as part of a wellbeing economy. This would be a monumental shift in working pattern that would require careful and detailed planning, a worrying prospect for many businesses already stretched thin and trying to make ends meet. When I asked the Cabinet Secretary for Finance and the Economy about the £10 million pilot, no detail was forthcoming. It was kicked into the long grass. And this is the problem. The SNP seem to be paying lip service to policy ideas without delivering on the detail. It's full of promises but no follow through. That's not just my view. Earlier this year, Carnegie UK identified an implementation gap between the Scottish Government's rhetoric and its delivery on fair work policies. The left-wing Jimmy Reid Foundation has similarly criticised the SNP Government of the 2016-2021 for its rhetoric not being matched by its actions and highlighted the devolved powers already at its disposal in this area. Presiding Officer, as we learn to live with COVID-19 and recover from the pandemic, we have the opportunity not just to revive our economy, but to reset it. We're building back fairer and greener. But during this period of change, we must be mindful as politicians to take people and businesses with us. We need to restore confidence as well as trust. Thank you.
Thank you. And before I call the next speaker, could I remind all members who are seeking to participate in this debate to ensure that they have, in fact, press the request to speak buttons. Thank you. And I now call Paul Sweeney up to 6 minutes, please, Mr. Sweeney.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Today's debate requires us to fundamentally consider what role the public sector should play in our economy. And for me, that answer is pretty straightforward. It should be a role model for the private sector, pushing standards up, creating minimum thresholds and requirements, while harnessing the huge economic power of the state to drive innovation and sustainability. We've heard the Minister proclaim what an excellent job the Government are doing in areas of fair work and procurement, citing the commitments made in the most recent programme for government. But my main query really is, why has it taken the Government all this time to commit to this agenda? It's taken 14 years in government for them to recognise that the measures just mentioned would help improve conditions for workers in Scotland. So the government can hardly claim that they are pioneers in this area. It's been the norm across Europe for years, though sadly not in the case of the British government under the Conservatives, have just ripped £1,040 a year out of the poorest households in work through their cuts to universal credit. So the government can hardly claim that they're priorities in Scotland, though obviously in the context of the UK, we're hardly going to take lectures from the opposition. Happy to take
Minister.
I thank the member for giving way, and I take note of his comments about European countries adopting all kinds of fair work measures years ago. Does he recognise that these are independent countries that have employment powers, and this Parliament does not have employment powers, they're reserved to the UK government?
Paul Sweeney.
Well, it's interesting that they're now being adopted in government as a result of new agreements with the Green Party. So I have to say, when it happened years ago, when my former colleague Neil Findlay moved amendment after amendment in this chamber over the last decade, calling for the real living wage to be a minimum requirement for public sector procurement contracts, and the government voted them down every time, it turns out the most recent agreement has simply meant that the government hiding behind lawyers has been exposed as a sham. And of course, when we see the rhetoric around fire and rehire, when only 8 of the SNP MPs out of 45 in the Westminster chamber turn up in the House of Commons to vote for Barry Gardiner's bill to ban fire and rehire, I think the rhetoric rings rather hollow. So, Deputy Presiding Officer, there is an element of... A couple of weeks ago, I asked the Transport Minister to join me in condemning ScotRail locking out its own work by suggesting that I was incapable of being impartial because I was a member of a trade union. We also have cleansing workers on strike in Glasgow during COP26 over a pay dispute with COSLA, and minority SNP administration in Glasgow tried to use Tory anti-trade union legislation to break the strike. So how can it be that this government, who are apparently so committed to the rights of workers, frequently finding themselves involved in industrial disputes with those same workers? How can it be that a government apparently so committed to trade union rights can contain a minister who brazenly disparages members of this Parliament and this chamber for merely being a member of a trade union? Happy to give way.
Maggie Chapman.
I thank Paul Sweeney for giving way. I just wonder what his comments are in relation to the STUC's demand in the Smith Commission process to devolve employment powers, and why his party, amongst others, refused to allow the devolution of those powers if he is so concerned for workers' rights.
Paul Sweeney.
Well, I would note that the Labour Party hasn't been in government since 2010, but it is actually Labour Party policy since adopted to support the devolution of employment rights as a floor to level up. So that is a welcome measure, and I would hope as a Democrat you would welcome that development in our politics, rather than trying to tread over history that has since long passed. So I would say that when we look at the context of how this government is behaving, perhaps many left-wing voters who have put their faith in the SNP to uphold their values might be pausing for thought as the true colours of certain ministers shine through. I know I welcome many of the measures already announced in the programme for government. I just don't think they go far enough. For example, there's still no ban on zero-hours contracts as part of the public procurement process. And we just need to look at the situation facing thousands of workers in the social care sector to see why. Many of them would be improved and helped by a commitment to ban zero-hours contracts, but we also need to go back to the point I raised at the outset. What role should the public sector play in our economy? Should it actively drive up standards or passively stifle them? And of course, we're seeing this play out across the UK when the Tories are discriminating against young people in their raising of the minimum wage by excluding under-23s. Happy to give way.
Jamie Halker-Johnson.
I thank the member for taking the intervention. I know he's part of a small but dwindling group of actual socialists left in the Labour Party. What I would ask is this question. There are a number within his own party who support a £15 an hour national living wage. Is he one of those people, and how would he pay for that?
Paul Sweeney.
I welcome the gentleman's intervention at this point, because I think it's very apposite, because I will actually offer an analysis. I hope the Deputy Premier will be somewhat generous having taken interventions.
I shall be reasonably generous to reflect the three interventions, but beyond that I cannot go. Thank you.
Thank you. I will do my best to persevere then. I've been a bit effusive. So certainly in 2019 the Fair Work Convention looked at the experience of workers in the social care sector, and I think it's fair to say their findings made for grim reading. The Convention described the current tender methods being used as untenable and directly responsible for the use of zeros, lowers and seasonal contracts, all of which undermine job security. And in the question of how you pay for an increase and pay in the social care sector is one example of how we can raise wages. The Feely report highlighted that for every pound spent in the social care sector. It would create a multiplier effect of £2 of GDP in the wider economy. So my request to the Minister is simple in this regard. When are we going to ban zero-hours contracts and pay Scotland's social care workers the £15 an hour wage they deserve? Because this is where I think the government are being short-sighted. Rather than looking at wages of £15 an hour as a way of reinvesting and pump-priming our economy's recovery from the biggest recession in history, Deputy Presiding Officer, they see it as expenditure that is somehow lost. So let's be clear here. These workers wouldn't be siphoning the money off into some offshore bank account. They would be spending it in their local communities, driving economic growth and tax revenue up. So I'm a firm believer in that role of the circular economy and the importance of community wealth building, like we see in the economic model of North Ayrshire, where the Labour Council leader, Joe Cullinane, is using that power of the public sector to invest in local community-owned energy generation, social housing and sustainable businesses. It's often described as being radical, but I'd argue it's not radical at all. It's entirely reasonable and it is increasingly essential if we are to improve living standards. So there's undoubtedly more that the government can do when it comes to driving this agenda, and that's why I'm committed, along with my Scottish Labour colleagues, to prioritising local communities and enterprise with a local-first approach. So whilst there's much to welcome in the Scottish Government's public procurement plans...
Mr. Sweeney, I have been generous. I've given you over a minute. Please bring your remarks.
I am at my peroration, Deputy Presiding Officer. It has taken far too long to get to where we are today, still far too short where we need to be. Progress has been painfully slow, and we should have been doing this long ago. We need less self-congratulatory rhetoric, okay. More ambition, okay. Firmer commitments, and quicker action.
Go. Thank you very much, Mr. Sweeney. And I now call on Willie Rennie. Up to 4 minutes, please, Mr. Rennie.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Yesterday, I visited the old paper mill at Garbridge, which used to be a paper mill, but has now been transformed into the Eden campus by the University of St Andrews. The campus is home to an award-winning biomass energy centre, providing heat to 43 buildings in St Andrews, as well as over 2,500 student rooms. It's also home to a new solar PV field, delivering electricity to the whole campus. Soon, it will be the home to a centre for energy storage and conversion, and, for the first of its kind in Scotland, a centre for battery development. Facilities also will be there for carbon capture to convert that carbon into a range of usable and valuable fuels and products. This is all part of the university's plans to be carbon net zero by 2035. It's a great partnership between the Council, the Scottish Government and the UK Government, and also as part of the Tay Cities deal. Many were sceptical, very sceptical, that these plans at the campus would ever be possible, but they have been delivered and they've done so at speed, which I think is an important first lesson when we're considering procurement and grants and government support. We need people who deliver, and we need people who deliver at speed, because the climate emergency is an emergency. It's all well and fine to have great plans for the future, but we need to deliver, and we need to deliver fast, which is why I think we need to look to institutions like St Andrews that have done so, and have done so incredibly well. I want to give credit to the government. I want to give credit to the government for eventually listening, because week in, week out, myself and others badgered the previous First Minister and the current First Minister over issues like Amazon. Amazon received millions of pounds of government support for very little in return. They were paying their staff very low wages and their working conditions were widely criticised. Yet the government were quite happy to give out millions of pounds of support. But the measures that are finally being put in place now will at last give support for workers like those at Amazon. But hiding behind lawyers 4 years has not helped thousands and thousands of workers who were desperate for their government to stand up for them at the time. And I think the Minister would do well to reflect on that pathetic excuse that he's rolled out this afternoon. I like to be fair, and I like to be fair to Amazon, because I think they are slowly improving pay and working conditions in its centres. It's got some way to go, but the feedback I receive is that they have changed, and they've changed for the better. but they need to go much further. And other companies should use this as a signal that they should be improving their working conditions and pay as well. It would also help if they paid a little bit more tax as well. But nevertheless, we've got to give them credit where it's due. However, the Scottish Government are squeezing out small businesses from the procurement budget. The share to SMEs has fallen to just 5%, and 200,000 fewer businesses are now getting a share of the government's massive procurement budget. If we wish to improve our local economies, cut the unnecessary transport of food and goods, then we must improve the access to these funds for SMEs. We've been banging on about this for years, but the government seems to be going in the wrong direction on it. I see the training programmes, I understand the information sessions that are held for businesses, but it's not delivering the change that we need for businesses in our communities. And finally, on housing, I am staggered. I referred to the Eden campus earlier on in my contribution. We have seen a biomass plant, a district heating system that's developed within sight of a new housing development in Garbridge. And what is powering the homes in that housing development? Gas. They're getting constructed right now. The opportunity was there for them to hook up to the district heating system. But for whatever reason, and I have my suspicions...
Mr Rennie, could you please bring your remarks to close? You're a bit over time.
The government and the council are not imposing the restrictions on housing developers to make sure they adopt the best possible practices in those homes. I think we need to get that changed if we're going to make a difference for the climate. Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer.
Thank you. And we now move to the open debate. And I call Michelle Thompson to be followed by Stephen Kerr. Up to 4 minutes, please, Ms Thompson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Given this debate is being held during COP26, I'll start by raising a point regarding our net zero and climate change ambitions. The Scottish Government's published some excellent guidance on many aspects of procurement that will effectively influence our future direction and enable judgment to be applied when awarding public sector contracts. Invitation to tender documents specify the criteria to be used, such as price in the award of contracts and the weighting to be given to them. And I simply note here that there is varying practice in the criteria when aligned to net zero ambitions. For some contracts, it's very clear and weightings are sought, but this isn't consistently applied. And it's my opinion that all our actions in the award of public sector contracts should contribute to reaching net zero. So with that in mind, would the Minister consider reviewing contract award criteria to ensure minimum criteria applied consistently across the board? Now, I don't underestimate the work required to make public procurement fit for net zero purpose, nor to ensure fair work, but it's vital there can be no fair work if we destroy the prospects for work. Now, I'm confident, and it's been mentioned here earlier, that there's wide agreement across the Chamber that as we come out of the pandemic, we'll not be reverting to business as usual, and we need to build a future for new circumstances. One of the key requirements will be to encourage much more innovation and entrepreneurial activity in Scotland. We need the development of new, more resilient local supply chains, all of which have implications for procurement policy and our Fair Work agenda. And we need to ensure new entrants to the marketplace are not disadvantaged because they lack a long track record. Perhaps on this occasion, one of the few occasions I've agreed with Willie Rennie, who brought that up earlier. We need to prioritise opportunities for innovation and new thinking that help us meet our obligations to current and future generations. And we need to hear new voices that are not thurled to the way things have been. We need to ensure fairness goes beyond traditional patterns of employment. We need to break down continuing barriers faced by women in business from part-time employment to entrepreneurs. One matter of particular concern to me is the lack of systematic impact analysis by sex for many business-related organisations. Now, in fairness, this should apply to other characteristics to encourage diversity generally. So does the Minister agree that the more evidence we have, the better the chance of subsequently developing policy that tackle barriers to participation? And would he consider looking at conditionality in procurement contract awards to increase diversity, which of course leads to greater economic contribution? It's to the great credit of the Scottish Government that they've been addressing for some time the need for better procurement policies and the need to develop policies regarding fair work. The recent extension from 5 to 7 elements of fair work demonstrate the ambition to keep updating and developing the forward-looking policies. And so I would conclude by saying, in many respects, whilst much progress has been made, we will never reach the end of our journey. In a world with faster and faster rates of technological, social, labour market and environmental change, we're all challenged, all of us here, to ensure our policy frameworks remain relevant to the world we are in by shaping our actions to fit.
Thank you. And I now call Stephen Kerr to be followed by Paul McLennan. Up to 4 minutes, please, Mr Kerr.
Deputy Presiding Officer, the scale of public sector spending in Scotland's economy is something quite stupendous. And yet this government, as my friend Tess White was at pains to point out, is reluctant to use that spend to bring about positive change. It was Edmund Burke who said, "If we command our wealth, we shall be rich and free. If our wealth commands us, we are poor indeed." This Parliament must see to it that the government uses the taxpayers' hard-earned cash to deliver value for money and sustainable benefit to Scotland. Leaving the European Union affords us an opportunity to see that more of our government spending ends up with Scotland's small and medium-sized businesses, the backbone of our economy. In short, we must put Scotland first. Whatever excuses have been given in the past for the lack of anything approaching a level playing field for Scotland's SMEs, those excuses are no longer valid, and we should use our new flexibilities to see that Scotland's SMEs are given a much fairer, more equal opportunity to win business in the public sector. It isn't easy for many of Scotland's SMEs to engage with the public sector. It's complex, it's expensive, and many SMEs simply don't get involved because they can't afford to. This must change. If ministers listened to business, they'd know about the excessive burden of red tape. They'd know how difficult it is to get onto certain frameworks. And it isn't going to change by the government complacently sitting back and doing nothing. I will.
Michelle Thompson.
Speaking in the chamber, but would I simply note that you have to understand the Scottish Government has an obligation to ensure that public money is spent effectively, and therefore the screening processes have to be rigorous. Surely there's two sides to this equation.
Stephen Kerr.
I'm grateful that the member's delighted to hear me speaking in the chamber. I think I do quite a bit of speaking in this chamber. But I take her point, but I'll come on to what she is referring to. Let me continue, and let's see if we can meet somewhere in between the two points that we currently seem to find ourselves in. When it comes to how contracts are awarded, we need to stop thinking solely about procurement in a financial or legalistic way, but in a way that accords with our values and with supporting our businesses. So I asked the minister, what is the government doing to make opportunity more equal when it comes to Scotland's SMEs? What is the government's ambition for Scotland's SMEs? What proportion of public spending, not the number of contracts, but actual money, will the government see is spent with SMEs by the end of this Parliament? And can I also identify probably the single biggest drag on economic activity and economic growth in this country? And that is the late payment of invoices. It is incredible the degree to which large organisations will manage their cash flow at the expense of smaller businesses by withholding payments. And it's not clever, and it's not fair. So what are ministers going to do to make their tier one contractors pay their suppliers' invoices in full and on time and within a reasonable number of days? And as my friends on these benches have said and will keep saying, we need a far greater level of openness and transparency from this government. Deputy Presiding Officer, I give you only one example of many. I've been asking questions for 6 months about the contractual relationship between NHS Scotland and ServiceNow of Santa Clara, California, and I've had a succession of non-answers from ministers. It's quite incredible just how secretive this government is. Audit Scotland has repeatedly referred to this sort of deliberate lack of transparency. Deputy Presiding Officer, it is the responsibility of this Parliament to scrutinise the executive, to ask questions.
Mr. Cowes is indeed, and you're nearly 40 seconds over your time. I have been generous because you did take an intervention, but could you please bring your remarks to close? Thank you.
It seems to many of us that the ministers do not agree. They seem to think it's none of our business to ask questions. Well, they might not be used to it and they might not like it, but it is our business and the questions will not go away.
I now call Paul McLennan to be followed by Richard Lennon. Up to 4 minutes, please, Mr. McLennan.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. We all want Scotland to be the best place to live, work, invest and do business. Scotland can make strides in fair work that will underpin our economic success as well as the well-being and prosperity of our people, communities and businesses that we all seek. Fair work will drive productivity and inspire innovation, all of which add value to jobs and to business and in turn create stronger, more sustainable and inclusive growth. It's at the heart of a well-being economy. Increasing the quality of jobs can improve outcomes for the people of Scotland. Fair work is also crucial to our ambition to eradicate child poverty by supporting families with children gain more income through employment and providing flexible job opportunities that respect caring responsibilities and other commitments workers may already have. The current pandemic has impacted significantly on the economy and highlighted inequalities. We need to embed fair work principles that will help Scotland respond to the challenges caused by the current pandemic, as well as the other issues that we're facing, including ageing, climate change, which has been mentioned, automation, the shift to home working, Brexit and changes in the patterns of global trade. We've heard now that fair work is now based on 7 principles. Fair work that offers effective voice, security, opportunity, fulfilment and, of course, respect. It balances the rights and responsibilities of employers and workers and generates benefits for individuals and society. I want to touch on these principles later on in my speech. The Scottish Government, of course, wants to use every opportunity possible to promote fair working and ensure people are paid at least the living wage. As we've heard, the Scottish Government is making payment of the real living wage condition of winning Scottish Government contracts and will engage widely to encourage this. In fact, the Local Government Committee was talking about this morning around about local authorities and how they can access procurement. We must acknowledge the valuable work that others such as the Fair Work Convention and the Poverty Alliance have undertaken in this area. By using procurement powers to ensure bidders pay the real living wage, the Scottish Government is leading by example to help influence employment practices and embed fair work principles. We all have a part in playing to encourage organisations, regardless of size, sector or location, to adopt the Scottish Government's progressive fair work approach on this. Everybody should have the opportunity to access secure and stable employment that offers a proper wage while affording staff the flexibility to balance their life and work balance. Through the Fair Work First criteria, the Scottish Government will incorporate the 7 key principles of the Fair Work, including effective voice. And I think effective voice includes trade union recognition, which is vitally important. In regards to opportunity for investment in workforce development, in regards to security, payment of the real living wage, and no use of unfair fire and rehire practices. Or in respect, including action to tackle the gender pay gap and create a more diverse and inclusive workforce. And in fulfilment, of course, investment in workforce development, support for family-friendly and flexible working practices. The Scottish Government, obviously, as the Cabinet Secretary has mentioned, will consult on its ambition to be a Fair Work Nation by 2025. An agreed vision, an action plan and milestones for delivery and monitoring will be produced by early 2022. The Scottish Government is committed to several initiatives, and we've heard about the Scottish Business Pledge, promotion of the living wage, workplace equality fund and, of course, supporting the Fair Work Convention, to name but a few. And I want to conclude, the Scottish Government has also established a £10 million fund to allow companies to pilot and explore the benefits of a 4-day working week. The Scottish Government will use the learning from this pilot to consider a more general shift to a 4-day working week as and when Scotland gains full control of employment rights. In conclusion, Presiding Officer, the next few years are critical in ensuring we make the progress needed to achieve this vision and meet the changing needs of our economy and our workers. Thank you.
Thank you. I now call Richard Leonard to be followed by Stephanie Callaghan. Up to 4 minutes, please, Mr Leonard.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. And can I refer members to my register of interests? I should really begin by thanking the Scottish Government for finally coming around to the Labour movement's way of thinking, that the award of £13 billion of public money every year for procuring goods and services by the Scottish Government and its agencies, around a third of all devolved public expenditure, will now be subject to these new fair work conditions and minimum labour standards, is on the face of it welcome. It's a pity it did not come sooner, and if it is legal now, was it illegal in 2016? Because of government havering, big public contracts like the £80 million awarded for the construction of the V&A in Dundee went to BAM, a company up to its neck in the construction industry blacklisting scandal going back decades. I've raised in Parliament before anti-union activity on the construction site of the new Dumfries and Galloway Royal Infirmary by another blacklister, Laing O'Rourke, where £275 million of public money was invested. And that on the Aberdeen Western Peripheral Route, built with £754 million of public money, workers were liable for both employees and employers' national insurance contributions and charged for the privilege of being paid their own wages by an umbrella company. It was a scandal of wage exploitation, cost-cutting and tax dodging, all going on with public money in our name. All important cases illustrating a more general problem, a systematic failure, all under the gaze of a government that was not prepared to act. And none of this is ancient history. The Dumfries and Galloway Royal Infirmary only became operational in December 2017. The V&A opened its doors in September 2018. The Western Peripheral Route in Aberdeen was only open to traffic in February 2019. Over £1 billion of public money was spent on these three contracts alone, and all were in the lifetime of the last session of this Parliament. So I say to the Government that we welcome their late conversion. We hope that this does herald a new era, that robust governance arrangements will now be put in place, that there will be not only contract monitoring, but contract compliance with tough penalty clauses to boot, and that ministers and principal accountable officers will be transparent and open to scrutiny by Parliament, its committees and the people. In the Labour Party, we have a wider vision of public procurement, which is based on a community wealth building model pioneered by Labour councils like North Ayrshire. That means ensuring that the award of public contracts does not give rise to massive leakages of investment and profits out of local economies, but rather strengthens local businesses, democratic ownership, local workers and the social fabric of local communities. It is a vision as well which demands action to take on and to take out tax avoiders from public procurement approved lists, not least in the provision of residential care for the elderly. And so finally, while I know that the government is currently talking about ethical commissioning and ethical procurement in care, when it comes to the creation of a national care service, there is a more profound argument that I would make, which is that these services should not be outsourced to the private sector and marketised at all, any more than National Health Service services and treatments should be outsourced and marketised. They should be run locally, in-house, democratically accountable, and the staff properly valued. That really would be the dawning of a new era. That really would be progressive. That really would be sustainable. That really would be fair.
Thank you very much indeed, Mr Leonard. I now call on Stephanie Callaghan, who will be followed by Maggie Chapman. Again, 4 minutes, please, Ms Callaghan.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. While Scotland has a proud tradition of progressive procurement, the twin challenges of climate change and COVID recovery mean Scotland once again looks to reform how we procure. The Scottish Government, recognising this pivotal moment for Scotland, must be commended for quickly resetting the procurement dial to ensure we harness the power of procurement for these unparalleled times. With an annual public procurement spend in excess of £12 billion, the scope to enhance the life of employees, marginalised and vulnerable groups, as well as protect our precious environment, is considerable. Public procurement has the ability to influence change across the business world for the betterment of people and places. Last week, I had the privilege of listening to South Lanarkshire students and what they expect me to do to ensure we protect our planet and their future. And a number of suggestions from pupils are certainly deliverable with more progressive procurement. For example, why does so much of what is delivered into schools still come in plastic packaging? Why do school meals include so few vegetarian and vegan options? And why are single-use face coverings used in school campuses? These are questions for all public sector procurement staff to consider now. We need to reflect, rethink and reset what we procure. Presiding officer, sustainable procurement also means growing our Indigenous supply chains. And we need look no further than the Scottish PPE supply base successfully expanded by the Scottish Government during the pandemic. This is not only providing Scottish jobs and security of supply, it's also delivering significant environmental benefits through reduced carbon footprint. So, a reset of how we procure will deliver substantial environmental benefits, but a reformed procurement will also support enhanced fair work practices across Scotland. I was delighted by the recent Scottish Government announcement that payment of the real living wage will be a condition of securing future Scottish public sector contracts. These contracts support a lot of Scottish jobs, around 110,000, and that's way more people than the whole population of my Uddingston and Bellshill constituency. So affirmative action by the Scottish Government around payment of the real living wage across the public sector is a transformative action, and I would encourage private sector organisations to follow suit. Using procurement to drive fair work practices across the Scottish economy will reduce in-work poverty and reduce societal inequalities. Scottish Government initiatives such as Fair Work First and the Scottish Business Pledge are incrementally changing employment practices across Scotland, and such redress cannot come quickly enough, with Tory Westminster policies hitting the pockets of the lowest paid hardest. Presiding officer, as well as low pay, embedding fair work practices in public sector procurement has the very real potential of increasing opportunities for family flexible working, reducing the gender pay gap, eliminating inappropriate use of zero-hour contracts and increasing worker representation in company decision-making. These life-enhancing improvements to fair work practices are particularly needed in sectors such as construction and social care, where job insecurity, low pay and or gender balance is more prevalent. Given these two sectors account for around 25% of Scottish public sector spend, it's clear procurement could be a real enabler for sectors crying out for positive change. For many years, the Scottish approach to procurement has been admired and replicated by other nations. In recent years, procurement has enabled Scotland to secure five times as many accredited living wage employers than the rest of the UK. I'm confident we can once again show global leadership. A more progressive approach to sustainable procurement provides us with an exciting opportunity to reimagine the kind of country that we want Scotland to be, a fair work nation. And finally, I have to just say that I'm delighted to welcome today's NHS Lanarkshire announcement that the new University Hospital Monklands, just 14 miles from the conference, will be fully net zero for both the build and operation phases. Some achievement. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms Callaghan. I now call on Maggie Chapman, who will be followed by John Mason. 4 minutes, Ms Chapman, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Thatcherism featured many crimes, but perhaps one of the greatest was to hand over the budget of public bodies for predation by private profiteers. Compulsory competitive tendering was a fantastic way to transfer wealth from communities to the balance sheets of corporations, very often reducing the quality of services and leaving the more complex and therefore more expensive services for local authorities and other public services to deal with, making the public sector look less efficient. And as the Fair Work Convention found, leading to downward pressures on public services budgets. We need a root and branch approach to eliminate this attitude in our public services. Our public spending should support the aims of our public bodies, not of people interested only in plunder and profit. So I'm delighted to see the rise of community wealth building approaches that use public spending to create better communities, more employment, and that don't undermine the shared aims of fairness, equality, and social justice. Procurement has been my guilty pleasure across my public service. One of the first things I did when elected as a councillor many moons ago was to identify ways in which local authorities could use their spending to better effect. I was the first Scottish politician to join calls for a living wage in 2008, and I am pleased that we have won that argument, even if at the time some of my colleagues thought it wasn't worth a hassle or couldn't see the difference between it and a minimum wage. I am proud of the commitments we secured in the cooperation deal with the Scottish Government on the living wage, and that we have already seen action on this. Requiring all government procurement contracts to pay the living wage will make a big impact on driving up pay and improving people's lives, embedding the Fair Work agenda into Scotland's economy more than ever before. Not naming any names, but some of those same colleagues 15 years ago also thought that we were doing such a good job on three-year funding, they refused calls for five-year funding for the voluntary sector. Instead, they regressed to single-year funding, a disaster for the third sector and something that must end. We must renew our relationship with the voluntary sector with sustainable funding relationships. We need to update the Scottish Compact that some 20 years ago gave hope to so many. What I was doing then has now been wrapped up into community wealth building, an approach that can transform our public services and deliver for our communities. Sustainable procurement is key to this. Procurement that means public kitchens, including school canteens, source food provided by local businesses and organic producers. Procurement that bases decisions about public sector, capital and revenue funding on targeted social, economic and environmental outcomes. But this debate isn't just about procurement. It's about treating workers with dignity and respect and compensating them accordingly. Fair work principles must be the norm. Payment of a real living wage, no precarious contracts, decent conditions, democratic engagement, including trade union recognition, and transparent supportive management. All procured services should be centred on ethical commissioning and fair work, which will be quality and individual outcome focused, collaborative, person-centred and human rights based. We must also acknowledge the global impact of our commissioning and procurement activities. Our supply chains too often include child labour, slavery and actions that drive climate breakdown. In the worst cases, they support human rights abuses, such as in the illegal occupation of the West Bank. Purchasing goods and services made in the illegal settlements in Palestine supports the illegal occupation, and no Scottish public body should be acting in support of that occupation. I would welcome a statement from the Scottish ministers on what actions are being taken to ensure that this ends. By pursuing community benefit...
You must conclude now, Ms Chapman.
In conclusion, Presiding Officer, by pursuing community benefit, human rights and community wealth building, we can transform our communities. I sincerely hope that in this term of Parliament, we can abandon the legacy and mindset of Thatcherism in public services and embrace community wealth building, because that way lies social and economic justice.
Thank you, Ms Chapman. I now call on John Mason to be followed by Liz Smith. 4 minutes, please, Mr Mason.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer, and thank you for the opportunity to speak in today's debate. It is certainly my desire that we see Scotland's economy growing, as there are more resources to share around, more tax can be paid, and then we can have more and better public services. However, economic growth comes in different forms, and if all of the benefits go to a very few people, then that is not acceptable and it is not good for the country. So along with growth in GDP and other similar measures, we need to see increasing fairness and sustainability, which is why it is important we are having this debate today. Now, it is true that we have seen progress in some areas in recent years, and at least women are now paid the same as men for the same job. However, it is only relatively recently that there was a breakthrough in Glasgow for men and women doing work of equal value, after years of labour inaction and collusion. And we still see sectors like the police and solicitors where more women are entering the profession but are not always getting promoted into senior positions in the numbers that I, for one, consider they should be. We need to use whatever powers we have in an imaginative way, and certainly that includes what conditions are attached to procurement exercises and to grants made. I think other countries have tried different approaches, for example, France breaking large contracts down into smaller chunks in order to support smaller local businesses. So the EU did not really hold us back. Obviously, part of this debate is where employment law should lie, and I would certainly prefer that to be in Scotland, whether under devolution or independence. However, I think we do have to accept that even with independence, we would face constraints as we compete internationally, and any movement to fairer work practices needs to have an international element to it as well. Just as we need COP26, an international agreement on climate change, so we need international agreement on fair work practices. On Brexit, I remain incredibly disappointed that we left the EU. We got some very good work practices from there, including a limit on the maximum working hours per week, apart from MSPs, of course. However, we were quite restricted in the conditions we could impose when procuring goods and services. But we are still going to be limited by the Internal Market Act and possibly by trade agreements the UK enters into. However, I hope we will push the boundaries on this as far as we can. And whether it be by using public procurement or making grants, we will ensure that decent pay and fair work practices are required as much as they possibly can be. Can I just mention McVitie's and the closure of the Tollcross plant in my constituency, which now seems almost inevitable? I think this brings the question of ownership into the debate. We have got used to the idea of big multinational corporations as being almost the sole and best model for enterprise. But it seems to me we need to focus more on other models too, including cooperatives and employee ownership. In these kind of models, there will be more commitment to the local area, more links to the local community, and in my opinion, more fair work practices. So I believe we need to do more to fend off the takeover of growing Scottish companies by big multinationals, wherever they are based. I don't think I've got time, have I?
We're very tight for time. We'd have to be accommodated, I'm afraid.
Yeah, I'm sorry. Another angle in all this is fair trade internationally. I absolutely want to see fair working practices, flexible working and a proper living wage and reduced gender pay gap for workers in Scotland. But I don't just want to see it for workers in Scotland. I also want to see workers in Malawi and Rwanda getting a living wage there too. And I want to see women in Zambia and Pakistan being paid the same as men in these countries. Fair trade has made great inroads on these issues, but we need to go further so that when we buy clothes from Bangladesh or coffee from Ghana, we pay a high enough price so that the workers in these countries also get a decent standard of living. Sustainable procurement and fair work practices can mean many things, but we need to keep our focus on them in the coming years and not just on GDP and other figures which are easy to measure. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Mason. And I call on Liz Smith, who will be followed by Katie Clark. And Ms. Smith, 4 minutes, please.
Thank you. And may I concentrate my remarks on the public procurement angle, because I think if we have the right public procurement, then we go a long way to ensuring that we get fair work practices. And I hope there is actually one thing that can unite this Parliament in these difficult times, and that is the drive to ensure that we get better value for public money and that we do so in as open and as transparent a manner as possible. Indeed, in my opinion, I think the public deserves no less. They surely have a right to know exactly where their money is going and why elected members of this place make certain choices, particularly when it comes to jobs and fair work. And we need to be held fully accountable for every decision that we make, especially when it comes to the public finances. The Finance Committee, and there are several members in the chamber this afternoon who sit on that committee, it certainly sees that scrutiny role as absolutely paramount in all its activities. And of course, so too does Audit Scotland. And we know that in 2018, the then Auditor General, Caroline Gardner, criticised the Scottish Government very strongly for the limited information that was made public available when it came to scrutinising the extent of the financial support that is given to several private companies. And obviously we've had the Ferguson, Bifab, Prestwick Airport situations where quite clearly the transparency has not been as good as it should be. And I think it's very important that when we recognise the request for openness and transparency, that there has to be a proper structure around Scottish Government consolidated accounts, because that was one of the clear problems when it came to Ferguson Marine, because although the was a fully government-owned company with Scottish ministers as the only shareholders, it didn't actually fall into the Scottish government consolidated accounts, and that's a serious problem. So I think Caroline Gardner is absolutely correct when she says that, and she said it persistently in her time in office, and her successor is doing exactly the same, that to deliver best value, we need to have good governance structures and effective management. After all, these are the structures what are required of local authorities, and so it should be absolutely the same case for the Scottish Government. The Minister mentioned in his remarks about the Procurement Reform Act of 2014, and that demanded that public bodies consider not only the economic outcomes of procurement, but also those that would enhance the social and environmental well-being, and several members have referred to that this afternoon as well. And clearly, this is obviously a very good week to be talking about these additional concerns when it comes to our social and environmental well-being. But I think there is a growing demand to help local economies, and my colleague Stephen Kerr mentioned this, Willie Rennie mentioned this. There's a lot more that we can be doing to help our local economies, and the FSB has made two very strong points on that front. Firstly, that it would be very good to see a much higher percentage of procurement funding going to smaller firms to help local jobs and local investment. And let's bear in mind that many of these smaller firms have been very much the bedrock of our communities during COVID. And of course, it's very true to say that COVID has not made things easy in terms of tracking the money, but neither should it be used as an excuse. So, Deputy Presiding Officer, may I finish on what I think is a very important point, that both openness and transparency are not only good practice to measure best value for taxpayers' money, but also because that openness and transparency is essential if there is to be renewed trust between government and the public. Because there's much in the media just now about how politics, maybe even politicians too, have lost their integrity when it comes to that transparency and openness. That's not good for society, it's not good for where our public money is going, and it's certainly not good for rebuilding Scotland after COVID.
Thank you very much indeed, Ms Smith. And I call on Katie Clark, who joins us remotely, and she'll be followed by Bob Doris. 4 minutes, Ms Clark, please.
Thank you very much, Deputy Presiding Officer. And this debate is about how public money is spent, but it's also about the kind of world that we want to live in. And the Fair Work First Guidelines describe themselves as a flagship policy to drive high quality and fair work across the labour market. And in the guidelines, the Scottish Government asks employers to adopt fair working practices. So I think one of the issues in this debate is to what extent these guidelines are mandatory, to what extent they're voluntary, and to what extent they're criteria that have to be taken into account when decisions are made. So, for example, one of the principles that's laid out is having appropriate channels for effective voice, such as trade union recognition. However, trade union recognition is not a requirement in the tendering process. So, for example, the Scottish Government in the recent past has awarded Amazon a £4.7 million contract for web services. That was last year. The year before, Amazon was awarded £45,272 in a contract, and in 2018-2019, £2.5 million was awarded in a contract. And they were also awarded £15 million in a tender for web services. And that's despite the fact that not a single Amazon warehouse in the whole of the UK is unionised. And indeed, even Amnesty International commented on how Amazon have repeatedly issued legal notices to trade union organisers who even attempt to talk to Amazon workers outside Amazon facilities in the UK. I know as a constituency member of parliament in the past, I was repeatedly approached by workers who lived in Ayrshire and who travelled to the Amazon warehouse in Inverclyde, and were told when they got there, even though they had a contract, that there was no work or there was very limited hours. Now, Amazon themselves say that they don't operate 0 hours contracts, but the reality of how the contracts work, according to Amazon workers, and indeed there was an ITV documentary about that about this fairly recently, is that in reality, the way that the contracts operate, there are 0 hours contracts. Another provision in the guidelines is that there should be no inappropriate use of 0 hours contracts. So I would like to ask the Scottish Government, in relation to these Fair Work guidelines, and in relation to the business pledge, which the Scottish Government asked contractors to commit to incorporate the principles, I would like to ask the Scottish Minister to clarify how many successful contractors have signed the business pledge in the past. The Minister indicated that companies would be mandated to pay the living wage. I would like to ask, to what extent does the government accept that it's really only when you mandate a company to adhere to certain principles that they are actually effective? So at the moment, we have companies such as Serco, who end up running asylum accommodation, and PricewaterhouseCoopers, who only very recently were awarded the £100,000 contract to design the new National Care Service. And I would ask the Scottish Government to outline how they believe that is consistent with the principles that are being set before Parliament today. Taxpayers have the right to expect that the public purse is used to support green jobs that are well paid. I welcome the debate today. I welcome what the Scottish Government has said, and indeed the contributions from across the chamber from the different political parties. Our role in this Parliament is to ensure that these warm words become a reality, and I hope that the Parliament will commit itself to doing that over the coming weeks.
Thank you, Ms Clark. And we now call the final speaker in the open debate, Bob Doris. 4 minutes, please, Mr Doris.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. And I want to begin during this short debate in discussing ageism during this debate on sustainable procurement and fair work. Much has been made of the UK Government's announcement that the minimum wage is increasing to £9.50 from April next year. And I'm sure the real living wage will consequently increase further in the next few weeks. Also, however, the rate for 21-22-year-olds will be £9.18, not £9.50. For 18-20-year-olds, it will be £6.83. And for 16-17-year-olds, it will be £4.81. I know only too well the use and abuse of those national minimum wages in the hospitality sector, some the bad practitioners in particular, and I hope that we can join across this chamber in saying that is simply wrong. It might be permissible, but it is wrong. And I'm sure the chamber wants to come together to oppose such an unfair, divisive and discriminatory approach to the UK minimum wage. And can I ask the Scottish Government what representations it has or will make to the UK Government to make the case to end such ageism in employment? I also welcome that the real living wage will now be a prerequisite to securing any Scottish Government contracts. That is, of course, just one element of a wider Fair Work First programme, which makes adoption of fair work practices as part of the criteria for securing public contracts and grants. I very much enjoyed Katie Clark's challenges to Government, and I wouldn't say too much more about Fair Work First in relation to that, but she made some very pertinent points, and I think I should put some of that on the record. So not only does the Scottish Government have to ensure that no ageism exists within Fair Work First, but we also have to make sure companies are compliant much more consistently across a range of contracts and grants they may secure from the Scottish Government. Presiding Officer, I am convener of the Scottish Parliament's Cross-Party Group on Palliative Care. Our members have a great interest in the development of a national social care system and of improving the pay and support of the social care workforce. That workforce must be at the centre of any Fair Work agenda. I welcome that last month we saw the Scottish Government introduce a £300 million package of measures to help health and social care staff. This included ensuring all adult social care staff who are currently paid the real living wage a pay rise of over 5%. That is a welcome start, but it is just a start. I'm minded of the words in the Independent Review of Adult Social Care, where it spoke about having to carry out job evaluations, ensure equitable assessments of terms and conditions, of skills, of qualifications, of responsibilities and the contributions made by social care staff, of national minimum terms and conditions, raising up standards, not lowering them within commissioning, whatever that may look like. And of course, at the heart of it, a national forum comprised of workforce representatives, employers, integrated joint boards in the Scottish Government. In other words, a national sector level collective bargaining structure. Presiding officer, that must be at the heart of any reform to adult social care. We should not pretend that national collective bargaining will immediately transform social care or it will be easy. It won't. But it is a key component, and it's a key component of fair work also. Of course, the funding must follow the support of any national care service also, not just because it's the right thing to do, but because of the equalities agenda, because of the gender aspects and the BME aspect, with women and black minority ethnic workers much more heavily represented in that sector. I'll finish off, Presiding Officer, by noting that the Scottish Government and COSLA are discussing a fiscal framework for local government. Depending on the outcome of the consultation for a national care service and depending on who picks up the tab for the aspiration that we want to see with the fair work agenda in the national care service, we'll have to make sure we fully fund the sector as we progress forward at the heart of the fair work agenda.
Thank you, Mr Doris. We now move to wind-up speeches, and I call on Colin Smith for around 6 minutes. Mr Smith.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. Can I begin by declaring an interest as a member of the GMB Union and Unite the Union, as well as being a member of the cross-party group on the RMT, and just in case any SNP member repeats the comments of the Transport Minister who suggested being a union member was a problem for an MSP, can I just say I'm proud to declare those interests. Presiding Officer, it really is, I think, the very definition of irony that the Scottish Government brought forward this debate today on fair work at a time our refuge collectors, our cleaners, thousands of council workers are taken to the streets not to collect their bins but to strike for fair pay, and when we've just had what was Britain's longest industrial dispute on our railways. Both disputes the Government showed little interest in resolving until ministers realised their COP selfies may end up being photobombed by striking rail and council workers. Our nurseries, however, are still balloting on industrial action because of the inaction of the Health Secretary since the pay offer was rejected. And last week, the Government snubbed retail workers by rejecting the call by Usda for large shops to close on New Year's Day. And we're witnessing, disappointingly, a level of anti-trade union rhetoric from some Scottish ministers. It means industrial relations between the Scottish Government and our key workers has plummeted to an all-time low. As Paul Sweeney said in his opening comments for Labour, how can it be that this Government, who are apparently so committed to the rights of workers, frequently find themselves involved in industrial disputes with those same workers? The reality is the SNP's record on fair work isn't as much progressive, but sadly it's all too often reluctant, and it has been for years. Positive steps are welcome, but it takes too long, and more often than not they do not go far enough. As Richard Leonard highlighted, we welcome the fact that the SNP have come round to the Labour movement's way of thinking when it comes to the payment of the living wage, including when it comes to the award of the over £13 billion of public money every year for procuring goods and services, but it's a pity it did not come sooner. I recall as a councillor in Dumfries and Galloway being, before I was elected to this Parliament, worried even then that we would face a recruitment crisis in social care because of cuts to council budgets, and that was driving an agenda of outsourcing of care for no other reason than it was cheaper to commission private and third sector care firms than it was to use council staff. So I propose that the council should seek a commitment from firms to pay the living wage as part of any council care commissions, and we work in partnership with firms to pay a fair price for fair pay. My proposal was booted out by the then Tory SNP coalition, who ran the council for most of the decade I was a councillor, with SNP councillors waving letters from SNP ministers telling them they couldn't support fair pay because it was illegal. It took the SNP nearly a decade to U-turn on a mechanism for paying the living wage to adult care workers, updating their legal advice as the minister described it. But we know that the whole system of commissioning, not co-production, that race to the bottom that is competitive tendering, is still a broken model. 2 years ago, the Fair Work Convention report on social work said that the procurement model was not delivering fair work. In fact, it was a barrier to it, responsible for 0 hours, low hours and seasonal contracts, undermining job security. It was being used to manage the savage cuts imposed on councils by Green and SNP budgets, leading in part to the social care recruitment crisis we are still facing, with staff being lost to sectors that offer better terms and conditions. In last year's budget, the SNP made no provision for an increase to social care pay. We need wholesale reform of social care, replacing competitive tendering with genuine collaboration. But that reform needs to start with a commitment to tackling poverty pay, adopting the GMB union's call for a minimum £15 an hour in social care. Well, Jamie Halcrow-Johnston asks, can we afford to do this? The reality is we can't afford not to. We currently spend hundreds of millions of pounds on delayed discharge, keeping people in hospital because poor wages mean we can't afford the social care staff to deliver the care packages that would enable those people to actually leave hospital. We need to stop believing that poor wages is good for the economy, that low pay is something that doesn't come with costs. It certainly will, yeah.
Jamie Halcrow-Johnston.
I thank the member for taking an intervention. Just to clarify, I was asking whether your colleague supported the 15 national living wage across the board and how that was going to be paid for.
Colin Smith.
And I've highlighted the fact that Labour very much supports that £15 for social care workers as a way to tackle the challenges that we face, particularly in social work. And hopefully, maybe Jamie Halcrow-Johnston will back our campaign on that as well, and more importantly, that of the trade unions. Because as Paul Sweeney said in response to what Mr Halcrow-Johnston said, the Feely report was very clear. For every £1 spent on social care, £2 is generated for the wider economy. So fair pay not only delivers for the workforce, crucially, the majority of whom are women, it also delivers a stronger economy. And it's vital that a stronger economy is more inclusive. Willie Rennie was correct when he highlighted the fact that at present our procurement processes squeeze out small businesses. He rightly highlighted that only 5% of the Scottish public sector's almost £14 billion procurement budget is spent with firms with fewer than 10 employees, despite these firms accounting for 94% of businesses in Scotland. The value of procurement contracts won by smaller firms has been in decline in Scotland since 2016. That's why Labour has consistently called for a local first approach to all procurement. It's why we want to see the commitment we secured in the legislation establishing the South of Scotland Enterprise Agency that embeds fair work in all grants to businesses, strengthened and extended to Highlands and Islands and Scottish enterprises. It's also why, as Katie Clark highlighted, we want conditionality in grants to businesses to go beyond just the living wage and vague commitments to fair work, but better mandate companies in areas such as collective bargain. And it's why Labour will always call for not just a stronger economy, but one that's more equal, more inclusive and fairer for all. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr Smith. I now call on Jamie Halcrow-Johnston to close for the Conservatives. 7 minutes, please.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Scotland's workforce has faced unprecedented challenges over the last 18 months. And for many, the nature of work has changed, or more accurately, the change that was already taking place has been accelerated. The effects have fallen on employer and employee alike. While businesses were shuttered, employment also seemed more precarious. Businesses stopped trading, while others limped on as their customer base collapsed under the weight of the public health emergency. Many enterprises survived. Some, regrettably, were lost. Key workers across sectors were faced with adapting and managing risk, ensuring that vital services could continue. The pressures placed on them have been immense, and in too many cases are still ongoing. So it's a welcome step that we're discussing fair work particularly, but also, as we have heard, sustainability in procurement. Hopefully we can each recognise the need to drive forward positive change and to continue, even redouble our efforts despite the impact of recent times. But we must also recognise that the nature of work is evolving before our eyes and must evolve if we are to meet the challenges of tomorrow. There remains an important role for this Parliament and the Scottish Government to be responsive to those changes, to adapt, to lead by example, and to ensure that the values of fairness are promoted. In many ways, the worst outcomes from the pandemic have been averted. It was thanks to the furlough scheme and other support mechanisms that our economy carried on, and that so many jobs and livelihoods were protected. And we've seen UK growth projections look increasingly solid, and the threat of huge rises in unemployment averted. That's a legacy we should all welcome. And moves have gone further. Despite challenges, the UK government last year surpassed the SNP's ambition of an £8.70 per hour minimum wage by 2020. And this spring, As announced by the Chancellor in last week's budget, the national living wage will rise to meet the Living Wage Foundation's £9.50 an hour. Good fair work involves fair pay, but it goes beyond that too. In relation to procurement, there is an opportunity to expand the promotion of skills and retraining, an aspiration the Scottish Government has stated is a priority. Part of this, as colleagues have observed, is about including support for apprenticeships, but it should also recognise the parallel need for reskilling and upskilling, building bases of expertise or providing support for transition. The 2014 Procurement Reform Act also recognised the merits of sustainability. On this week in particular, environmental sustainability should be at the forefront of our minds. But in pursuing these aspirations, we should also recognise the need for an approach that is inclusive. It would be very easy to use procurement to drive forward these ambitions, but in a way that was exclusionary, that created a narrow door which only few could enter. Avoiding that outcome was another of the principles of the 2014 Act, and one that we should take seriously in turning principle into action. Because it's not such a great stretch to see how such an outcome, one that limits potential sources of procurement, limits the utility of the measures we're discussing today. It would also, just as importantly, strike at the very fundamentals of government procurement, finding value for money that the public has entrusted us to spend. Scotland has an incredible diversity of innovative and creative SMEs, SMEs that are trailblazers in new areas and drive competition in others. This is particularly true in regions like mine, the Highlands and Islands, where smaller enterprises are the lifeblood of our economy, and where government procurement can make so much of a difference. We know that there are barriers of access for smaller businesses already, as other members have pointed out, but we must be in business of lowering rather than raising these walls. Presiding Officer, there have been a range of useful contributions from around the Chamber. My colleague Tess White spoke of this as a time to take stock and to ask ourselves the sometimes difficult questions about what we, both as state and society, can do and improve. Sustainability is an often used term, but one which encompasses a great deal, and it depends both on clarity of purpose and an understanding of the effects of our interventions. Tess White also highlighted the importance of suppliers to an organisation's overall social and environmental footprint, as well as emphasising the importance of education and innovation. She also spoke about the importance of engagement. We know all too well the consequences of that in this government's anti-business approach and the problems it has created. Attempts at making positive change must be on the basis of working with employers and other organisations, not against them. Liz Smith spoke about the issues raised by committees of this Parliament, as well as the Auditor General of Scotland, in relation to the transparency of procurement. She mentioned, amongst others, the current issues faced at Ferguson Marine on the Clyde, an issue that was brought up in detail in my members' debate on ferries just last week. While we recognise the issues around commercial sensitivity, it's clear that there remains a lack of openness on important and high-value procurement and support to businesses from the Scottish Government. This was, as Liz Smith pointed out, a vital part of good governance and effective management. She also touched on the issue of support for small businesses, a point also raised by Willie Rennie and also by my colleague Stephen Kerr, who highlighted some of those challenges faced by smaller businesses and operations in accessing public procurement. The continued issue of late payments, something which should be simple to correct in today's work, remains just one, but it's something that we can see a difference between business succeeding and failing. Yes, I will.
Jim Fairley.
Oh, thank you. You surprised me. You're talking about small businesses and the need to support them. Does the member share my position that the increase from 5% to 7.5% for the hospitality sector on the 1st of October imposed by the UK government is anything but business friendly? And a hospitality sector first to shut down, last to open, being brutalised by a lack of staff because of the lack of free movement of people. So how do you stand on the 5.5% or the 7.5% rise in VAT?
I'm sorry if my letting the member intervene surprised him. He did actually try and intervene on me, so I'm slightly surprised by that. The UK government has supported business, and if you go out into the communities, businesses will say how important that UK government support has been. And I tell you what, they will also tell the member how difficult it has been to access some of the Scottish government support, how there has been a lack of clarity, how there have been delays of getting that support through, how there have been far too many different pots which have made it even harder. So I'm sure that's a message that the member himself will have been getting as well. The presiding officer, sorry, there is an important role for this Parliament. and in promoting sustainability and positive employment practices in a changing world. But it must be an approach that is collaborative and responsive to change. Without these key requirements, the influence of this Parliament and the Scottish Government has will be greatly diminished. In furthering the principles of sustainable recruitment, we should look to the future, to the coming needs of our wider society, and consider whether, in the round, public authorities in Scotland are making a positive contribution. Thank you
very much indeed, Mr. Hargreaves-Johnson. I call on the Minister to wind up the debate for around 9 minutes. Mr. Lockhead.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Thank you to all members for the contribution to this debate. It's a very important debate. It's a debate that affects every working Scot and every Scottish employer. It takes place against the backdrop of us all witnessing the impact of COVID, which has exposed and highlighted many of the unacceptable features of our economy and some people's working lives. And of course, it's against the backdrop of the impact of Brexit, and also as we look ahead with COP26 taking place as to the economic transformation our country will have to go through in the coming decades to meet our 2045 net zero targets, which again will have an impact on every working Scot and every business in this country. And it's also a debate, as Katie Clark said, about the kind of country that we want to build. I want to refer to some of the powerful contributions made by many members and answer some of the questions if I can, and also comment on some of the other comments. I have to start with Jamie Halcrow-Johnson saying, in response to Jim Fairley's excellent intervention, that the Conservative Party are pro-business, because if I recall, it was the Conservative PM Boris Johnson who was not very complimentary about business, and he said the word business, which was preceded by a four-letter expletive, which I won't say in Parliament because I like to adhere to the standards of this place. But it wasn't anyone else. It was the Conservative Prime Minister that said that.
Jamie Halcrow-Johnson.
I'm just wondering if the member, because obviously he's slightly trying to deflect there, can I ask him how many businesses in his Moray constituent have commented, have come forward to him about the difficulties they've had in accessing Scottish Government support? The confusion, the lack of clarity, the problems they face. How many have come to him?
Minister?
Ironically, I was about to refer to some businesses in my own constituency as well as the rest of Scotland, because I was also intrigued by Tessie White's comments, where she had the audacity to say that this government, the SNP government, is not listening to the hospitality sector in Scotland. Because I do speak to the hospitality sector. I speak to them in my constituency in Moray and other organisations through my ministerial role as well. And what their number one concern is the impact of Brexit on Scotland's hospitality sector. And I put it to Tess White. It is not SNP or Green ministers that are not listening to the hospitality sector. It is our colleagues in the Conservative UK government in London. I also was intrigued that Tessa White was saying on the one hand that the Scottish Government has to be very careful about the impact of our fair work criteria on business and our measures in business, and then immediately afterwards in the same breath she said that we should listen to the recommendations, as I quote her, of the left-wing Jimmy Reid Foundation. So I'm sure the Jimmy Reid Foundation will be delighted they've got a supporter and a Conservative MP on their benches. I just want to address some of the comments made by some members. Firstly, Michelle Thompson spoke about sustainable procurement, and many members spoke about procurement. Procurement, of course, is just one of the windows to the Fair Work agenda, but I know that many members explore some of the issues around procurement. I should say that in public procurement in Scotland, we really have been pushing out the boundaries of what is permissible for the last two decades in this Parliament. And there's now a major focus on ensuring that public procurement contributes to a green and inclusive recovery. And I want to just give Michelle Thompson that assurance. Maggie Chapman referred to the issues around procurement and government contracts in relation to the occupied territories. And I should again say that the Scottish Government takes the issue of human rights very seriously and believes those we contract with should take a robust approach to preventing human rights violations in any part of their business and including their supply chain. And that's reflected in much of the procurement legislation as well. Now, I'm embarrassed to find myself to a degree agreeing with Stephen Kerr on one particular issue, because Well, I'll come back to that later, actually. But I want to address one point he did make, which I don't agree with him. I'll come back to the issue I do agree with him to where I do not agree with him entirely, because he did refer, as others did, to the recent rise in the national living wage. But whilst welcome, that is not nearly as generous as it sounds, as others have said. I think it was Bob Doris that referred to that. It does not support those workers under the age of 23, who are one of the groups most affected by the recession, and it does not compensate for the £20 a week cut to universal credit. And it will soon be woefully short of the new real living wage rate, which is set to increase again on the 15th of November at Living Wage Week in 2021. So I read in the newspapers this week that the UK Chancellor, the Conservative Chancellor, is the richest elected politician in the UK. So I don't think we're particularly surprised that he missed that opportunity to do more for the low-paid in this country. Where I do agree with Stephen Kerr on one issue he raised and some other members as well, is the need to do more to ensure that small to medium-sized businesses do benefit from procurement and the spending of public pounds and their local economies. And there's cross-party support, I hope, I know from many parties, to support community wealth building as part of the government's agenda and this parliament's agenda going forward. And people will be aware that there's five pillars to the community wealth building agenda, one of which is making financial power work for local places, another is fair employment and just labour markets, and one is socially productive use of land and property. So, yeah.
Tess White.
Will the minister please respond to
the microphone, please, Ms. White.
Thank you. Can the minister please explain how the SNP government believes it can manage work when it disastrously can't manage its ferries, improve the attainment gap, and it can't manage and improve its drug deaths record?
Okay, I think the minister...
Just as I reach a conclusion, what would help us deal with the challenges facing working people in Scotland is having employment powers devolved to this Parliament. Yeah. We have no competence to legislate and reserve matters such as setting the minimum wage, trade union laws, employment rights, protections against discrimination or enforcement action. And many members, when they were speaking, actually made the case for these powers to be devolved to this Parliament when they were calling for action to be taken, which we don't have the legislative power to take in this Parliament. So I would ask you all to get behind the efforts of the government to get employment legislation devolved to Scotland's Parliament. Have I got time?
No, I'm afraid, Minister, you must bring your mics to close.
In closing, this government has achieved so much over the last few years in terms of the Fair Work agenda and the absence of legislative powers over employment. We have, through our Fair Work First criterion, public sector grants and procurement, asked employers to commit to appropriate channels for effective voices for staff, such as trade union recognition, investment in workforce development, no inappropriate use of zero-hours contracts, action to tackle the gender pay gap and create a more diverse and inclusive workplace, and payment of the living wage. And I'd remind people there's more people pay the living wage in Scotland than other parts of the UK as well. And as from October, two additional criteria have been added to the Fair Work agenda. Employers are asked to offer flexible and family-friendly working practices for all workers and oppose fire and rehire practices. And over and above that, there's the other issues we've been discussing today over conditionality through public grants and procurement as well. So I urge everyone to submit to the Scottish Government's consultation on creating Scotland's a Fair Work Nation by 2025. But under the SNP leadership and with the support of the Green Party, we are making fantastic progress to creating Scotland as a Fair Work Nation.
Thank you, Minister. That concludes the debate on a progressive approach to sustainable procurement and fair work practices. Point of order, Mr. Finlay.
Thank you. Earlier today, I asked the Cabinet Secretary for Justice about a Scottish Prison Service policy in respect of prison mail. The policy is that contaminated mail items are given to prisoners upon their release. I explained that officers were angry and worried by this. I further stated that they, quote, feel complicit in what they describe as state-sponsored drug dealing. In response to this, the Cabinet Secretary stated, and I also quote, "I don't think it's right to call prison officers drug dealers, even to try and make a political point." Now, as a new MSP, I try to avoid making personal attacks and false comments.
Could we hear the point of order, please?
I strive to avoid making personal attacks and false comments about colleagues of all parties. I would like to ask you, Deputy Presiding Officer, with respect to Standing Order 7.3 relating to members' order in the Chamber, what options are available to you or to myself in respect of the Cabinet Secretary's false and deeply offensive comment?
I thank the member for his point of order. As the member will be aware, the content of contributions during proceedings is the responsibility of members themselves. Excuse me, Mr. Halker-Johnson, I'm in the middle of responding to your colleague's point of order. Thank you. As the member will be aware, the content of contributions during proceedings is the responsibility of members themselves and not a matter for the presiding officer. There is a place for a robust debate and discussion in this chamber, but members are expected to treat each other with courtesy and respect at all times. Should I or my colleagues in the chair consider that a lack of courtesy or respect is being shown, we will intervene. Thank you. It is now time to move on to the next item of business, and the next item of business is consideration of business motion 1914 in the name of George Adam on behalf of the Parliamentary Bureau, setting out changes to this week's business. I call on George Adam, Minister, to move the motion.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and moved.
Thank you, Minister, and I see that... Is Mr. Golden trying to press his... We've established today doesn't seem to work. Perhaps Mr. Golden could move seat. Apologies for that. It didn't seem to work earlier for Mr. Kerr. Okay, I call on Maurice Golden. Thank you.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. I seek your guidance on how Parliament will allow members to scrutinise the Scottish Government and how this Government operates with the transparency expected of a Scottish Government. Members will have noted the Government's intention to provide a statement on incineration and deposit return, but not until after COP26. Given the Government has all the evidence now, then why the delay? We can only assume it's because they are going to deliver bad news, news that could embarrass them in front of the world at COP26. And why are the two equally important environmental issues being bundled into one statement? That can only mean less scrutiny. This is to spare the blushes of the SNP Green Coalition. In fact, incineration could have been dealt with 2 years ago. That's when Zero Waste Scotland forecasted the SNP were headed for more than 1 million tonnes of incineration overcapacity. Overcapacity that could see the SNP Green Coalition importing waste to burn, but perhaps more importantly, consigning future Scottish governments to do the same. The Greens already promised a ban on new incinerators in their manifesto, but now they announce a nonsensical review, meaning that more incinerators can be built, which will make Scotland the ashtray of Europe. And there's been very little on the deposit return scheme promised for July the 1st next year.
Can I just remind members to please, if we could please listen to Mr. Golden across the chamber, including on the Labour benches. Thank you.
Very little, despite working on it for a decade. My letter to the Minister is still unanswered after a month. This is a Government hiding from parliamentary scrutiny. Deputy Presiding Officer, it's time the SNP Greens took their responsibilities seriously and allowed Parliament to question them on their shambolic record on tackling climate change.
Thank you, and I call on George Adam, Minister, to respond on behalf of the Parliamentary Bureau. Mr. Adam.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And can I say from the start to Mr. Golden, in answer to his questions he had there, that there is no conspiracy in this whole scenario. There is no lone shooter in the grassy knoll. It is effectively just a case of parliamentary business and getting through the parliamentary business. And what I'll say, Presiding Officer, is I'm trying to be reasonable, as always. I'm trying to be reasonable with everyone in the chamber, and when requests are made by opposition parties, I try to work with them.
And incidentally, Presiding Officer, I'm trying to be a better person as well. I'm trying to make sure I can see others' points of view and work with them in such a way that we can actually work for the betterment of the people of Scotland. But on this issue, it's purely process. As much of what my job as Minister for Parliamentary Business is, much of it is process. And the Scottish Government has accepted two statements this week, one from Labour and one from the Conservatives. The request for a statement on action for legal aid solicitors will take place tomorrow, which was what this motion proposes. A statement covering the incineration review has been scheduled for Wednesday, the 17th of November. And this is the basis of arguments that the Conservatives have made at Parliamentary Bureau on a number of occasions. Number one, the Conservatives requested that we lessen the pressure and the intensity of parliamentary business for the duration of COP26. The Bureau accepted and agreed with this proposal. Two, the Conservatives also repeatedly requested that we maximise scrutiny of government policy. I believe that having it in the date that we are proposing actually gives the Conservatives the opportunity to get more publicity and actually ask their questions, because currently the whole world is quite rightly looking at Glasgow for COP26. So I've listened to the Conservatives on the basis of both of their points, scheduled a statement on the incineration review for the week immediately following COP26 to allow all members to participate without any conflicting commitments. Presiding Officer, this is me being reasonable. This is me trying to help colleagues to make sure the flow of parliamentary business can go as easily as possible. And it's purely just for the process and not for the conspiracies that the Conservatives believe.
Thank you. So I will now put the question. Point of order, Stephen Kerr.
I would like to point out, Deputy Presiding Officer, that my offers in the Bureau to accommodate this special period in the history of our country, when we are hosting the largest gathering of world leaders in the United Kingdom, perhaps ever, was intended to be in the spirit of working across this Parliament in order to facilitate that. I have to say, at no point have any of my overtures to the Minister for Parliamentary Business been intended to convey the idea that we were anything less than keenly interested in the scrutiny of this Scottish Government. And therefore, I hope that the Minister for Parliamentary Business understands what he has insinuated by his remarks today and the consequences that will flow from it.
That is not a point of order. I now put the question. The question is that motion 1914 be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The motion is therefore agreed. And we will now move to decision time. And in fact, there are no divisions as a result of today's business. And so I will now move on to the next item of business after a short pause to allow people to change their seats. Thank you.